Good evening, hello and welcome. You're with the news today. Your primetime destination is Thursday night. This is where you'll get all the news and the headlines, the nine headlines at nine tonight. The Supreme Court now orders the center to ensure free travel for stranded migrants to their home states by trains and buses. Our state governments, railways to arrange food during the journey. India Today was the first to expose how migrants were being charged for their travel. The viral videos that haunted a nation. India Today tracks down the little baby who lost his mother during a train journey home from Gujarat to Bihar. Now Bihar's netas offer cash to the child who's safely with his grandparents. India joins the global hunt for a vaccine. Principal scientific advisor says aim is to develop a COVID vaccine by next year. Center collaborates with 3 out of 30 groups working on vaccine development in the country. More cases of infected flyers emerge after domestic flights resume. 6 found COVID positive on a Chennai-Salem flight. 1 positive case reported on the Bengaluru-Madurai flight. Indian forces claim to have foiled another Pulwama-style attack by the Jaish-e-Mohammed. Car loaded with explosives disarmed. The terrorists managed to escape. More proof emerges of Chinese buildup along the line of actual control. Satellite imagery shows troop buildup at Pangong So. India rejects Trump's mediation offer. Locust swarm spreads now to 5 states across north and central India. Delhi government issues alert of a possible locust attack in the city. Center steps up the effort to contain the insect menace. U.S. President Donald Trump warns to reviewing law that protected Twitter, Facebook from being responsible for the material posted by their users. Social media giants slammed the move. Facebook calls it not the right reflex. And great news for sports fans. The English Premier League is set to restart on the 17th of June. Manchester City to play Arsenal on the day of resumption. And our newsmaker tonight to take all questions from the economy to migrant labor, from the vaccine to the lockdown. Newsmaker Amitabh Kant, Niti Aayog CEO, will join us tonight. But as always, first our overall figures. These are the total number of cases that we have at the moment in the country. Take a look at the numbers that we have. 1,51,767 are the total numbers that we have at the moment in the country. Deaths are 4,337. These are the numbers. You can see it on the key graphics in a moment that will come on your screen. In the last 24 hours, total cases are 6,566. Deaths are 194. The worst hit states remain the same. Maharashtra, 56,948, deaths 1,897, Tamil Nadu 18,545, deaths are 133, and Delhi, which has now replaced Gujarat in terms of number of cases, 15,257, deaths 303. Remember, Gujarat though has a higher mortality rate at the moment. So those are some of the numbers that we need to look at the moment. The Corona India dashboard that keeps tracking the numbers day after day. Now, while migrant workers continue their arduous journey home, that's our top story, because today the Supreme Court jumped in to provide much needed relief to the faceless victims of the lockdown. The court today put the onus on the states to provide help to the stranded migrants, from food to shelter to providing free tickets. It's our top story tonight, as we focus on the nowhere people.
Lakhs of migrant workers on trains and on the road. Thousands of them facing shortage of food, water as they head home. The Supreme Court today stepped in. The court, in an interim order on petitions filed by NGOs, has directed state governments not to charge migrant workers for their trains or bus journey. The Supreme Court asked the states to provide workers wherever they are stranded. States have to provide food before the migrants board trains and after they reach the destination. The railway has to provide food during the journey. The states shall also oversee the registration of migrant workers and help them take a train or a bus at an early date. The order was given by a three-judge bench headed by Justice Ashok Bhushan. Solicitor General Tushar Mehta, representing the state, said the railways has run 3,700 Sharmik trains, in which more than 95 lakh migrants have availed services.
The center and the states have now been asked by the Supreme Court to file detailed reports with numbers of the people on the road trying to go home, the transport facilities created, and all other facilities being provided.
Meanwhile, politics is raging over the migrant crisis. Congress chief Sonia Gandhi, in a video message, lashed out at the government.
Hamara kendra sarkar se fir agrah hai ki khazane ka taala kholiye aur zaruratmandon ko rahat dijiye. Har parivar ko 6 mahine ke liye 7500 rupaye pratima seedhe cash bhuktan kare.
There have been millions of Indians who have been brought back home via train, via planes, via ships. From across the world, millions who have gone between state to state. The government of India and state governments have stood resolutely and worked together to ensure that these citizens of our country get support.
All this while these faceless masses continue to suffer. They have become victims of an insensitive political ping pong. Bureau Report, India Today.
That's right, these are the nowhere people. Remember the heartbreaking visual of a child sitting next to his dead mother in Muzaffarpur's railway station in Bihar that we showed you last night had shaken the nation. India Today now has tracked down the family to her village in Katihar in Bihar. The child, the good news is safely with his parents. Here is the story of Arbina and her two children.
Images that shook India. A child fiddling with the blanket over his dead mother on a railway platform in Muzaffarpur, Bihar. The deceased, identified as Arbina, was a laborer in Gujarat. And like lakhs of migrant workers, she was rendered jobless under the lockdown. Arbina was a divorcee. Her two children are now in Katihar with their grandparents. Her family, in a statement to railways, had said she had undergone heart surgery in March.
जो मरी है वो आपकी कौन है?
साली है.
कैसे मरी?
ये ऐसे ही मरा है अचानक.
कुछ बीमारी पहले से?
बीमारी उमारी कुछ नहीं था.
मतलब खाना वाना मिला था?
हाँ, खाना वाना सही मिला था. पानी का बोतल हर चीज मिला था. मतलब कोई शैतानी असर था इसकी वजह से मरा.
Railway officials had earlier clarified that Arbina developed a sudden illness during the journey.
Ahmedabad se Madhubani train jati hai. Usi train se ugar raha tha. Raste mein uski achanak tabiyat kharab ho gayi aur death ho gaya. Aadhe din mein yahan train pahunchi to train se utar gaya. Hum logo ko suchna mili to uska jo bhi kagaj prakriya hai pura kiye.
Nahi na abhi aur sab nahi pahuncha hai.
People, including local leaders, are flocking to Arbina's home, offering monetary relief.
मैं चाहूंगा सरकार इनको जो है कम से कम 10 लाख का मुआवजा दे. इनके आश्रितों को कम से कम घर मुहाय कराया जाए. काफी इनका कच्चा मकान है, इनको घर मिले, बच्चों को रहने के लिए एक छाया मिल जाए.
Arbina's death is just one in a series of heartbreaking stories as lakhs of migrant workers make their way home. Bureau Report, India Today.
Now remember, this great Indian reverse migration remains one of the most heartbreaking, if not the most heartbreaking, fallouts of the lockdown that the country has witnessed for the last 2 months. But there is another fallout of this, and that's been on the economy. In the last few weeks, as attempts have been made to open up the economy gradually, the truth is industrial units, especially small and micro units, are facing a labor shortage. Today we bring you the ground reality of what is happening. Take a look at a special report.
After waiting it out for over 60 days at home, Atmanesan is back at his MSME unit in Chennai's Ambattur Industrial Estate. But things are a bit different this time at his factory that manufactures automobile parts.
There is no order. These materials are March schedule. So I want to give work to the workers. That's why we are running.
Machines are roaring again. Some workers are back at work. But buyers are nowhere in sight. Equipped with a face covering and sanitizer bottle as per government norms, Mary has resumed work in Atmanesan's factory. Mary says she was unemployed for 5 months last year, and just when things started to get better, the pandemic struck.
வாடகை 4 மாசமா கொடுக்கல. சார் 2 மாசம் சம்பளம் போட்டு கொடுத்து அந்த வாடகை கொடுத்தோம். ஏதோ இருக்கறதை வச்சு சாப்பிட்டோம்.
At factories where work has restarted, lack of orders isn't the only hurdle. Getting labor is also a major issue. Many migrant workers employed with MSME units have left the city for their native places. Like at this unit, 16 employees used to make the tools, but now 4 have resumed work.
We are in financial crisis now. These people are depending on us only. They are working for us. Actually, after March month, we have salary given fully. After that, April, we are given the 50% of the salary.
MSMEs did face hiccups when they were resuming operations. One was finding their workforce who hadn't left the city. Now they haven't started production in full scale just yet, as there are no buyers in the market, and they are hoping for the situation to ease out over the next few months.
Over to the textile hub of India, Gujarat's Surat saw massive protests by migrant workers as the mills were under a lockdown. Now that the mills have reopened, the workers are hard to find.
वैसे तो अगर 100% हमें मिल चलानी हो तो 400 कामदार लगते हैं 200 दिन में और 200 रात में, लेकिन अभी हमारे पास कुल मिला के 200 वर्कर यहाँ रह गए हैं. 400 वर्कर में से 200 अपने अपने प्रांत में चले गए हैं.
In UP's Noida, Aarti's MSME unit that once used to export products to Bangladesh and Vietnam is now struggling to stay afloat. While some production has resumed, the strength of workers has come down to 10 from 65. And Aarti says that the government's relief package is of no use to her.
All are loaded already with the, you know, so many loans and all. We were looking forward to a waiver of the interest charges on the loan period, especially for those past 2 months when there was no production taking place.
Delhi's Bhavana industrial area is facing similar issues. No orders and no workers. This area houses around 16,000 factories employing 10 to 12 workers each. But now 90% of the labor force has left.
व्यापारी के पास ना ऑर्डर है ना लेबर है ना उसके पास काम है.
Now as far as the challenges are concerned, they claim that first of all the migrant laborers have moved back to their native places, and second, they have been paying their bills from last 2 months, but the government has not given any waiver in those bills. With camera person Vinod, this is Munish Pandey in Delhi for India Today.
So two big issues, in fact multiple issues, that face the country at the moment. There is the economic crisis, there's the migrant labor crisis, there's the corona crisis, and there's the lockdown issue. To respond to these issues, I'm joined by a special guest, the CEO of Niti Aayog, Amitabh Kant, joins me. Appreciate your joining us, Mr. Kant. It's now 2 weeks. Let's start with the economy first. It's 2 weeks now since the economic package was announced to revive economic activity. But our reports from the ground here are showing economic activity, especially of small and micro industries, is simply not reviving because there is still a lockdown in place. Labor shortages are in place. There is a public transport concern. Do you concede, sir, that as long as the lockdown continues, it's very difficult to revive the economy?
So Rajdeep, let me give you a broad overview. If you look at only the MSME sector, it's about close to 65% of the MSMEs are operational. If you look at their full capacity utilization, about 35% of them are operational. But if you look across the industry, There are some sectors which have become fully operational, that is FMCG, food processing, etc. If you look at the ports of India, they are operating to about 75% utilization now, other than Kandla. Kandla is operating to about 50%. There are two challenges which we are facing as we going along. For the full supply chain to be fully operational, two key challenges. One is that workers had gone back home. Mm-hmm. There's an element of fear which we need to get rid of. Mm-hmm. One of the key challenges for everybody in the system will be that we have to get rid of this fear element and say that this is a disease like any other disease. Mm-hmm. And therefore, people have to get back to work for the economy to get revived again, fully operational, made fully operational. And this is very important. Secondly, I think the transport sector is now opening up. The buses are opening up. States are getting transport to get moving. Buses, railways will start moving. The civil aviation sector has opened up. So I think it's been a calibrated approach. And I think in the next couple of days, you'll see the transport sector fully operational. And the third key challenge to my mind will be, as we go along, some of the big shopping malls, etc. So some sectors like textiles, etc.,
right.
They are not fully operational because the front end has not opened up.
Mr. Khan,
that will open up.
Mr. Khan, let me stop you there. Let's come one by one. You say transport has opened up. The fact is Mumbai, sir, which is the commercial capital of the country, which is the engine of the economy. There's no public transport and no sign that it's going to be resumed anytime soon. There's a stiff lockdown there. As far as migrant labor goes, you've admitted many of them have simply gone back and are not returning, it appears, in a hurry. Now, until you get migrant labor and transport back, how can you actually get the economy back on track? You need transport to be revived, you need the migrant labor to return.
So Rajiv, let me tell you the reality on ground.
Mm-hmm.
That 19 cities in India today are contributing to about 76% of the total infection in India.
Mm-hmm.
19 cities. 5 cities in India are contributing to more than about 50%. Now these 5 cities are critical for India. But it's important to understand that it's not the entire city which is, fully impacted. We need to follow a very, very strong hyper-localized strategy. We need to open up other areas so that economic activities get cracking. And that has been what the Government of India's strategy is right now. Focus on strong containment in very small hyper-local areas.
Mm-hmm.
Rest of the areas we need to open out. Secondly, I think state administration also must focus on this same strategy, because important thing is that while we are trying to protect lives,
mm-hmm.
we should not be losing out livelihoods of people. We need to get the economy back cracking, and this is important.
Mm-hmm.
Now this is a challenge. What you are telling me is a challenge.
No, Mr. Khan, those are fine words, lives and livelihoods. My point, sir, is, for example, labor, which would you admit has been a failure, the ability to retain labor. When you imposed the lockdown, you gave just 4 hours notice, people stayed in. Now when you want to relax the lockdown, open up activities, the same migrant labor has gone back from the cities to the villages. Was that a failure on the part of the decision makers to understand the impact the lockdown would have on those left without incomes and therefore having to go home?
Rajdeep, this was an unprecedented crisis. One must understand this. When commentators like you make this kind of comments, it's extremely unfortunate. This is an unparalleled situation. We have lots of migrant workers who've gone back. But as the economic activity revives, I'm absolutely sure all industries are today giving incentives for workers to come back. And as the economic activity revives, I'm absolutely sure that workers will come back. But in the meantime, when the workers have gone back, government is taking care of them through increased outlays for MNREGA increased provision of food of 5 kilos plus 1 kilogram of chana, 5 kilograms of rice and wheat. But I'm absolutely sure as the industrial activity opens and in US, we are seeing also workers coming back to work, and we are seeing a vast number of industries giving incentives for workers to come back. So you will see this coming back to normalcy.
You don't concede, Mr. Khan, that one of the errors of judgment that the government made was that the lockdown, in a sense, was imposed, as I said, with just a 4-hour notice all too soon. And now when you're opening up, labor and transport remain in a crisis. Are you going to concede at the moment that these two issues, labor and transport, have been failures in the manner that perhaps they are now playing out?
No, Rajdeep, this was a very, very unprecedented scenario. Our first and foremost concern of the government at that point of time, the only concern was that we should be able to contain the spread of virus. We were envisaging an exponential growth. We were able to curb that. We gave ourselves time so that we could get PPE. We could do a lot of testing. We have the capacity to do only 500 tests. We are doing about 1.2 lakh tests now. We've been able to contain our mortality rate to just about 2.8%. This is unprecedented. Our recovery rates have shot up now to 42.8%. This is really a remarkable achievement on part of India. We must realize that there has been huge challenges. We've been able to confront these challenges.
Mr. Khan, I don't think anyone should minimize the challenges that the government has faced, particularly, as you said, the balance between lives and livelihoods. But when, for example, an industrialist like Rajiv Bajaj, a plain-speaking industrialist, comes on our channel and says, look, this lockdown has been draconian, it is not allowing economic activity to open up, it has put far too many severe conditions on industry, that the package that you've done, the stimulus package, has no wow factor, do you concede that you've not been able to put cash in people's hands, those who desperately need income? Are the Rajiv Bajajis right or wrong when they say that as long as the lockdown remains in this draconian form, you can't revive the income consumption demand cycle?
Let me put things in a proper perspective. And I've heard Rajiv Bajaj's arguments, his very forceful arguments, I've heard them very clearly. Let me tell you, Rajiv Bajaj is a dynamic entrepreneur. The government's perspective is to look after the entire country. At that point of time, nobody knew how the virus would behave. At that particular point of time, it was very important that we impose a lockdown to ensure that we give ourselves adequate time. Several studies, several epidemiologists, several doctors had said that there is likelihood of an exponential growth, and this would have happened and it would have been uncontrollable because we were not adequately prepared. What the lockdowns have done is to give the government adequate time, including state governments, adequate time to manage this crisis. We did not have any PPE, we did not have any ventilators, we did not have any testing. We've given ourselves time, and having given ourselves time and prepared ourselves, now it's possible for us, because of this lockdown, to now open up with sanity and spread out and open up your economic activity. And that is what the government has done. If we hadn't done this, we would have met with similar mortality rates as European countries have done, and this would have been very, very unfortunate. We have been able to save people's lives. We've been able to improve our recovery rate.
I take all your points, sir, but as many observers say, it's much more difficult to open up, have a clear exit plan, than enforce a lockdown. The question that I want to know is, as you prepare this exit plan, as you prepare the need to get the economy back on track, it comes back to it. How about the key question that many economists are asking, where is the cash that is being put in people's pockets? That has not happened. You had a stimulus package 2 weeks ago. It brought in liquidity, it's brought in credit, but it hasn't put cash in hand. Is that a weakness that now somehow needs to be addressed to revive, as I said, the consumption demand cycle?
So Rajdeep, the government has done a lot, you know, in terms of several packages, five different packages. One of the key things it's done for the migrant workers is to ensure that they get adequate food on hand, which was critical. In addition to food on hand, you know, the government then subsequently came out and said, even if you don't have a ration card, you'll have 5 kilos of wheat and rice and 1 kilogram of chana. But in addition to that, we, you know, I was heading one of the empowered groups. We yes. mobilized 92,000 NGOs to provide food, etc. But packages, if you look at the packages, they're extremely quite systematically structured. If you look at the MSME package, in addition to 3 lakh crores of lending flowing in from financial institutions, then you have a fund of funds of about 50,000 crores, and you have another subordinate debt flowing in for 20,000 crores. I think we should allow these packages to play out because a lot of structural reforms have also been implemented. Allow these packages to play out. And I'm quite sure...
My point, sir, is that... If all this is happening, why is business confidence so low? Why are most rating agencies now saying we will contract by at least 5%, whether it's Fitch, Standard and Poor, some even giving us a negative growth rate? Why do I see no business confidence, no enthusiasm post the packages that you gave? As I come back to it, will we actually therefore see the economy contracting by as much as 5%? And is the government of Narendra Modi living in denial?
Well, Rajdeep, let me tell you, it's too early for all this. I think the implementation of the packages has just begun. I think several other people have saying is too early. What the country has demonstrated is that it is possible for us to handle this lockout, and now it's possible for us to revive our economy in many ways. There's huge confidence in India. We've seen a huge FDI growth, and I'm quite sure we'll be able to drive this further. There's a massive amount of interest in investments in India. Large scale investments have come in. We've seen the whole focus on Atmanirbhar Bharat. Our objective will be to see that we are able to push domestic manufacturing in a big way. Our objective will also be to see that domestic demand picks up. Sir, there's no reason why in due course we'll not take a series of other measures to push for domestic demand as well. Sir, and we will ensure that we'll
sir, my point is, sir, sorry to interrupt, the Atmanirbhar Bharat is a fine buzzword. What then explains the doom and gloom, the negativism, including in an industry you know well, in a previous avatar, tourism? You know that industry well. That industry is in a crisis. They tell me that they've got nothing in these packages the government announced. They don't know how to revive, and there's a general sense as we head into another potential lockdown in a few days of an element of pessimism about the economic revival. How do you then, in this age of COVID and lockdown times, get back that feel-good factor?
So Rajdeep, let me first tell you that I do not feel there is a scenario of doom and gloom and pessimism as you are painting it out to be. Now, some sectors have been impacted, and all over the world, look across the world, tourism has been impacted. It was the first sector to have got impacted. Airlines have got impacted across the world. We've been able to, the biggest stimulation we can provide to these sectors is to open them up as early as possible. Once they are opened up, we should push for domestic tourism. I think that should be the strategy. And I'm absolutely sure that in due course, as tourism opens up, like we've opened up civil aviation, like we'll open up in due course retail markets, etc., you will see demand picking up. I have no doubt in my mind that tourism will again be a very key driving force of India. Right. It's just a matter of time. You are asking, you're painting a picture of gloom, you're painting a picture of pessimism, which is not correct. Indians must be Indians.
Sir,
Mr. Khan,
it's not me who's painting this picture of doom and gloom. It's the world's global, the best rating agencies in the world. It's these agencies that are saying that India's economy is likely to contract by 5%. They are painting this image of gloom and doom. And the fact is, that's the reality on the ground that our reporters are also finding.
So Rajdeep, tell me one country one country across the world where growth will not contract. Growth will contract across the world. Our challenge will be to open up as quickly as possible and drive with vigor and energy different sectors of the economy which have been impacted. Our objective should be to ensure that credit flow takes place. Our objective should be that demand picks up. Mm-hmm. It's a vicious cycle which we must break and ensure that growth takes off in India. And that's what the strategy is.
Mr. Khan, let me ask you this. 4 days are left for the end of the lockdown 4.0. There's talk of another lockdown. Do you concede that this lockdown strategy is now subject to diminishing returns? You say you've achieved certain objectives that you set off in March in terms of health infrastructure, in terms of controlling, in a sense, the spread of the virus. But do you now believe that it's subject to diminishing returns and that really now the government needs to relook afresh at the next phase in June? Because if this continues, and the longer it continues, it becomes much more difficult to revive the economy. Incomes are being lost, jobs are being lost.
So Rajdeep, I think if you look at the last particular sets of policy announcements, all key sectors of the Indian economy have been opened up, including the civil aviation sector. I think the strategy is to open up all sectors and ensure that we are able to contain only areas where the spread is enormous, and this, unfortunately, this is happening in some of the commercial cities, but it should be containment at a local level rather than the entire city. Mm-hmm. And open up all other areas for economic activity, and this is so very obvious from what the government of India has done. And I think that is the strategy which other states and districts, we are in a very large country, we are bigger than 25 countries of Europe, and therefore you need to take the states along, you need to take the districts along, everybody along, and I think that is the strategy which states and districts must all follow, that open up economic activity as much as possible. I think now is the time for an opening up of the economy so that jobs are back.
Sir, on first principles, I don't think anyone will disagree with you. You mentioned, though, that jobs are back. The fact is CMIE latest data shows that job losses are at the highest since liberalization. That you've got in rural area, one in every four persons is unemployed. These are serious figures. I just want to understand, is the government aware of the gravity of the situation, or is the government living in denial and trying to talk up an economy at a time when the reality is that we are in big trouble?
No, Rajdeep, nobody is in denial. It's a crisis situation as far as jobs are concerned. I said jobs must get back. Try and understand what I'm saying, that we must get the factories to start working, we must get the transport sector to open up, we must get our shopping areas to open up, and that will enable jobs to get back. And I'm absolutely sure in my mind that migrant workers who've gone back to their villages will in due course of time come back to the same factories. Mm-hmm. After all, factories are today working at with about 65 to 70%. You know, 70% means about 50 to 55% of the workers have actually come back to these factories. Where the workers have not yet come back are construction sites, large construction areas. And I'm quite sure that as we open up, as transportation opens up, as the element of fear and stigma vanishes, you will see more and more people coming back. And we must ensure that jobs get back. India, there's a lot of informality of workers. We must ensure that they must come back to work.
So that's precisely it. The informal sector that you just mentioned, that's the one which is hurting. I want to ask you this, sir. Do you have any regrets, any introspection? As someone who has been associated with government for years, as you look back last 2 months closely, is there anything you think the government could have done differently, perhaps done better, that would put us in a better position? Or do you believe the government has done nothing wrong? Has it done missteps, whether it's the way it dealt with the migrant labor issue, whether it's the manner in which the lockdown was enforced in the first instance? Are you telling me there are no lessons to be learnt?
So Rajdeep, this was a crisis of unprecedented proportions. One of the key challenges in this particular country was that you have states where there are migrant workers in large numbers, and then you have states which are receiving states. Now try and understand that one state is wanting to, the workers are restless to go back, states are wanting to send them back, and the receiving states, the concerned districts, the concerned panchayats are not wanting to receive them back because there's an element of fear of spread of virus. You know, it's very easy for commentators like you to keep commenting that there has been a failure, but look at the challenge which the government was facing. Look at the challenge which the administration was facing. Look at the scenario of a large country where workers wanting to go back, states wanting to send them back, and states not wanting to receive them back. Saying that irrespective of that, we want to walk all the way and go. So there were huge challenges.
Mr. Khan, I am not for a moment minimizing the challenges, but maybe it could have been done better. Maybe the great Indian railways network, maybe the great Indian bureaucracy could have functioned in greater coordination. As I said, state-central coordination could have been better in handling the migrant crisis. Maybe too much power has been centered around a few bureaucrats in Delhi and PMO rather than decentralizing, which you are now speaking about. Do you believe, I repeat, that things could have actually been worked out much better on the ground to avoid this human tragedy?
So, you know, on the migrant labor issue, I personally feel that states should have interacted with each other much better. There should have been better coordination at the state and district level. And at the district level, wherever the workers were, because adequate amount of freedom was given in terms of the state disaster relief fund. Funds were provided to the districts, to the states, to the districts. Everybody, the funds was provided. They should have been taken adequate care of at the district and the state level. In a large federal polity like India, the closer you are to the ground, you should be able to solve the problem. Sir, putting the entire onus to the central government would not be fair and correct.
Sir, I take your point, but the fact is, in the actual manner in which this lockdown has played out, it appeared for a long time that Delhi knows best. Delhi was issuing all the notifications, changing it. You've been a bureaucrat in a state. We need to reinforce, as you say, federalism. But there is a fear that the lockdown, rather than strengthening federalism, has only strengthened decision-making in a Delhi-centric perspective by a handful of bureaucrats, rather than being inclusive. I come back to it. Don't you think it's time for a national task force which contains the best and brightest, not just from the bureaucracy and the government, but maybe from all fields across the world? That's what's happening. The best bankers, the best academics, the best economists are being brought together to combat COVID. That's not happening in India, where you've got a small group of bureaucrats taking these decisions.
So are you telling me that all decisions have been taken singularly by the central government? Hasn't the Prime Minister consulted the Chief Minister of the state time and again and again and again? Over 5 times the Chief Ministers have been consulted. Every single decision of the central government has been taken in consultation with the state government.
All I'm saying is, do you think that there is a time for a national task force, the best and the brightest? There have been 5 meetings, yes, between the Prime Minister and Chief Minister, but there is a sense that states feel, and this is what Chief Ministers tell us when the opposition Chief Minister, that they've not been involved. Decisions are taken at the last moment in an ad hoc manner. That now the time to have a task force that meets regularly, not just of bureaucrats and politicians, but the best and brightest.
No. Are you telling me that in a federal polity, the task, you can have a bigger task force than consulting all the chief ministers of the state? Every chief minister of the state has been consulted, and at every time the prime minister has consulted them and taken a decision based on the inputs given by the state governments. And there can't be a bigger task force than this. This is consultation at the highest possible elected level.
But do you believe that there is a wide variation in the way certain states are combating COVID versus others? Certain states, including Gujarat, are not doing enough in terms of testing. Remember, this is and there are other states that are accused of testing very little. Do you believe that's a worry, that as migrants go back to Odisha, Bihar, Bengal, the virus could spread, and to that extent, we could have two Indias in a way?
So, Rajdeep, let me give you my perspective, and that is that we've managed to give ourselves adequate time. The mortality rates in India are extremely low. They're just about 2.8%. This is the lowest figure in the world today. And we should be really worried at the end of the day how we've tackled this pandemic is a function of how many deaths you've had. And this is extremely low in India. What we should ensure is that people with comorbidity are kept at home. We should increase our level of testing. And definitely our recovery rate is on the rise. It's crossed 42%, 42.5% today. That's a very, very high recovery rate. So to my assessment, India has done extremely well. It's not the spread of the cases. The spread of virus will happen irrespective of anything, but we must ensure that our mortality and fatality rates are kept low and our recovery rates must continue to rise.
You know, at the end of the day, Mr. Khan, you are calling in this program for greater center-state coordination, which sadly, as I keep saying, doesn't seem to have happened at the ground. For example, the mess over railways. We've had battle between the railways and the states over issues like trains. Is your message going to be heard, I hope, by those in power, that there will be greater state coordination in the months ahead and the Niti Aayog will play a role in that?
But Rajdeep, I think you must understand the nature of the challenge. You know, the nature of the challenge was that many states were not willing, the communities were not willing to accept workers coming in because there was a fear of the pandemic spreading out at that particular point of time. You know, the states were wanting to send, some states were not willing to accept.
But sir, the fear was created, let me be honest, by the government. You know, when you say fear was created, who created the fear? Who said that we are in a world war situation? Do you think that somewhere the government's communication created the fear among many people that we are in a war-like situation? Police Danda Raj in a way was put in. Could the communication have been better, especially in the early days, that there was a need to reach out and explain to people that don't worry, Corona is not a stigma. It's not something to be scared of.
No. So, Rajdeep, a lot of that effort has been done. Constant communication with the state governments, district administration has been done on a constant regular basis. Not only at the highest level, but by the cabinet secretary at regular levels have constantly been done. It's not that communication has not been done. It's, you know, it's been a regular constant level of interaction.
Okay, let me leave it there, Mr. Khan. You've answered all my questions today and I appreciate that because it is good to have someone from the government come and take the questions head on and answer them so clearly. Appreciate your joining us. Let's turn to tonight's other special story. India's locust nightmare has now spread to multiple states, Rajasthan remaining the worst affected, but crops in UP, Punjab, Maharashtra, Haryana, Madhya Pradesh also affected. Let's take a look as we track the locust spread. Ankit Tyagi reports.
A sea of buzzing brown hungry swarms of locust has taken over the skies of several states in India. India today is chasing one such swarm moving from Rajasthan to Uttar Pradesh or maybe cross the national capital.
Swarms of locusts, desert locusts that invaded from Pakistan are right now creating a lot of problems, destruction in Rajasthan. We are here in the Dausa district of Rajasthan where the government overnight in fact had run an operation and you can see thousands of these desert locusts lying here, almost dead. Many still push as if their life is concerned.
An average swarm of these insects from the grasshopper family can eat up acres of standing crop within an hour, posing serious threat to farmers and food security.
ये एक्चुअल में हम क्या है कि जहाँ जिस जिले से ये आता है माइग्रेट होके
जी
उस जिले के जो वहाँ के अधिकारी हैं कृषि विभाग के उनसे हम संपर्क में रहते हैं और इसकी लोकेट करते रहते हैं कि कहाँ पे आ रहा है और फिर हम पूरी रूपरेखा बनाते हैं और उसके बाद करीब एक बजे के आसपास मिडनाइट के बाद ये ऑपरेशन हम चालू करते हैं क्यों कि उस वक्त ये टिड्डियां पेड़ों पे बिल्कुल आराम से सेट हो जाती है और डिस्टर्ब नहीं होती.
Experts say that these little insects can fly up to 150 kilometers at a stretch before settling down to feed. Rajasthan is facing its worst locust attack in nearly three decades. A wave of locust swarms have swept many cities, including capital Jaipur. The way to prevent them is loud noise, fire torches, and spraying of pesticide. Jaipur administration is using drones to keep an eye on locust movement. Locusts have left trail of destruction and misery in western Madhya Pradesh, Jhansi in Uttar Pradesh and parts of Maharashtra. An alert has been sounded in Haryana and Punjab. The Delhi government too has issued an advisory over possible locust attack. The state governments and Union Agricultural Ministry have stepped up control operations in affected districts. The government is also procuring 60 massive spraying machines from UK. Bureau Report, India Today.
And joining me now is Sunita Narayan, the Director General, Center for Science and Environment, and someone who's tracked this issue closely. Sunita, this locust swarm has really taken over, in a sense, parts of the country. And I saw a webinar where you seem to link it to climate change. For our viewers today, explain to us why you believe this locust menace is being linked to climate change.
You know, Rajdeep, it's quite simple. The fact is that locusts really breed, and they breed exponentially if the weather conditions and the vegetation is right. Now, what has happened over the last 2 years has been extremely unseasonal rain and cyclones happening over the Arabian Peninsula. And we, you know, your all the viewers and you would remember that actually there has been, whether it was Luban or the other, or more recently the Pavan, which are absolutely not known. I mean, in the Arabian Peninsula, you had lakes. And that essentially created a huge breeding ground for locusts. Locusts are desert creatures. They die. But the fact is, if they get vegetation and if they get unseasonal rainfall, then they will breed. Mm-hmm. And that same locust then moved, some part of it moved to Africa, and there has been huge swathes of locusts destroying, whether it's been in Kenya, Ethiopia, Yemen, areas that we never hear of. And the tragedy of the matter is that at the time when the first locust attack were happening in Africa and in Rajasthan in December of this year, all of us were focused on the forest fires in Africa, in Australia, which were also happening because of climate change. Mm-hmm. But something happening in our own backyard, happening because of the same variable extreme rainfall, unseasonal rainfall, creating this.
So are you saying therefore that what we've seen this year is likely to now happen on a more regular basis, that this locust attack of this kind, which has come after 4 decades, could now take place every year?
Well, every year, every now and then, because you've now created unseasonal rainfall. I mean, just think about it. We've had extended monsoons. Last year, the monsoon didn't retreat for a long time. The locusts would have migrated back into the dry lands. They never migrated back. They lived back in Rajasthan and bred. And as your reporter has so correctly said, these locusts, and for us who are so coronavirus focus, one of the things we have to remember is that locusts also breed exponentially. You know, the first time it's 20, then it's 400, and then the next time it's 16,000. Wow. So you have exponential growth. So yes, there is massive danger that this could happen much more because of unseasonal rainfall, vegetation being created, new breeding grounds for them, which means we need to tackle this at a war footing.
Sunita Narayan, as always, a pleasure talking to you, to get us a sense of why you chose to link what's happened with the locusts to climate change. Wish we had more time, but maybe we'll come back to you one of these days, because the locust story isn't going anywhere. Thank you so much for joining me here on the news today. Let's turn to our good news story. Now, we've heard about migrants who've struggled to go home by foot, by truck, by buses, by tractors, by trains. But what about those who are getting a chance to fly? At the initiative of the alumni of the National Law School in Bangalore, 180 migrants from Jharkhand, stranded in Mumbai for over 2 months due to the lockdown, flew back to Ranchi this morning on a special chartered flight. The migrants are a happy lot after reaching their home state by air. It's our good news today story.
We have seen moving images of migrants taking never-ending journeys home. but there are some stories with a much happier start and ending. Waiting to board a chartered flight home at Mumbai Airport, these are 180 migrants who were stranded for 2 months, let alone taking a flight. They had never seen the inside of an airport.
Flight mein ki pehli baithi hai?
Nahi, pehli baar baith rahe.
Dar lag raha?
Ab baithe hain, bhi baithenge tab to pata chalega.
Acha. Socha tha koi aapke liye flight kar dega jaane ke liye, kyunki yahan to train bhi mushkil se mil rahi thi.
Nahi, aap log ka kripa hai.
Theek hai. Khushi hai wapas ja rahi hai?
Haan, ja rahe hain wapas. Bahut khushi hai.
मुझसे पता है लोग का खाने पीने का भी जो नहीं काम चलेगा तभी तो खिला पाएंगे, नहीं काम चलेगा तो कैसा खिला पाएंगे सर। परिवार में इधर रूम का देना पड़ता है, भाड़ा देना पड़ता है, इधर किराया मांग रहा है तो मालिक बोलता है 2 महीना 3 महीना देख लिया अभी कितना देगा, इसके लिए हमको जाना पड़ रहा है सर।
Their dream of going home took wings thanks to the generosity of the alumni of National Law School of India University in Bengaluru, who along with some NGOs arranged air tickets to Ranchi for the 180 migrants.
We've organized 180, which is a full plane load, what actually drove us to it is that, you know, we were trying to think about an efficient way of trying to get people home safely and as quickly as possible, you know, and then this opportunity came about as in somebody had a brainwave amongst us.
After landing in Ranchi, the migrants wore smiles which narrated their relief. After all, they took just 2 hours to cover the distance which the less lucky ones would have taken weeks on foot.
प्रियंका मैडम जी,
प्रियंका मैडम
जी जी
ठीक है
जी,
उनसे बात हुई,
उनसे बात हुई
हाँ,
तो वो फिर मेरा करवाया, बहुत हेल्प उसने की, उनका मैं थैंक यू बोलना चाहता हूँ उनको।
Amid the tales of misery and misfortune, these happy smiles stand out and reaffirm our faith in humanity. With Pankaj Upadhyay and Satyajit, Bureau Report, India Today.
All I can tell the NLS students today, what an idea, Sarji and Madam G. Really first class. Okay, let's leave you with two images tonight. An 18-day-old baby girl discharged from a hospital in Mumbai after battling COVID-19. She's probably the youngest patient to defeat the novel virus. Despite her mother testing negative for COVID-19, within 3 hours, the baby started showing symptoms, but she's fully recovered. This is, I think, at the Hiranandani Hospital there in Mumbai. So well done for that speedy recovery that's taken place in Mumbai. And I want to leave you with my other image tonight, because even though coronavirus cases are on the rise, there are also many people who are battling this deadly virus and recovering. A 103-year-old Massachusetts woman celebrated her recovery with, guess what, chilled beer. Her pictures of holding an ice-cold Bud Light have gone viral on social media. Nice image for a change to end the show with. Stay well, stay safe. We shall be fine. This too shall pass. Good night.